good morning also to our YouTube audience. Appreciate your checking in with us. This is the Caron Chapel service for December 13th, 2020. And peculiar times in this calendar year, and we're happy to be able to sort of broadcast the morning message from the chapel service. We look forward to the day when we can welcome alumni and families back to the table. So, delighted to sort of run into a topic that I have tremendous passion about, and I'm going to take a look at the clock and try and watch to not overuse time, so that we have time for patient sharing and the other music and prayer pieces that we have ahead. When I began my journey of recovery, one of the very pivotal things that happened early on, in fact, it was the very first AA meeting that I went to, I was handed a piece of, before I would do the treatment work and other things that I would do to sustain my recovery in the long term, I was handed a piece of paper, and I thought, oh, this is like school, it's great, they have handouts. So I didn't realize that subsequent meetings I would go to, I wouldn't get handouts. But anyway, on the piece of paper was a document that was referred to as the Promises. It's an Alcoholics Anonymous passage. It comes from an AA big book. And I'll make reference to it later, but one of the very first promises in this text that is in the larger volume is a new freedom and a new happiness. And I cannot say I remember terribly well in the fog of the pit of my addiction what that said to me, but I do know that the next morning I take my piece of paper and pasted it to my refrigerator door and sought further help and would begin my recovery. That was January 3rd of 1989, so it's, God willing, soon to be 32 years since I had my last prayer. Thank you. So, that's given me a lot of time to sort of test out, what do I think that means? What does a new freedom mean? I'm speaking to you with 32 years of reflection on the promise that was made to me the first day I got here. And I guess the first thing I want to say is that as I stayed, stuck and stayed, I stayed sober one day at a time. Good days, bad days, sunny days, cloudy days, financially secure days, like, didn't matter. Any day with a Y in it, I used to drink. Now, any day with a Y in it, I was going to not drink. That was my basic, solid commitment. And what began to happen is I started realizing just how captive I had been. I thought of a joke on my drive in this morning. I was thinking of several of them, but I'll tell the shortest one because I am thinking about time. So the joke is, the optimist looks at the glass and says the glass is half full. The pessimist looks at the glass and says the glass is half empty. The alcoholic looks at the glass and says, hey, you gonna finish that? This is part of the essential captivity of the illness. And I will ask you to bear with me because I will refer to alcohol and alcoholism and addiction without being terribly mindful or conscious. So I'm not trying to super correct myself, but I realize that this illness manifests in a variety of ways. So if it's food, if it's shopping, if it's gambling, if it's sex, if it's relationships, whatever, please give me the generosity of your spirit to hear what I'm saying. I'm not trying to exclude anybody. I'm just trying to keep it simple and get through to the deeper points of what I have to say. So anyway, that was my captivity. I didn't see the glass of either half full or half empty. I was preoccupied with who was going to get to finish it. And that goes actually way back from that. I remember as a child finishing adult drinks. Like I would go around as a kid when my parents were partying and I would sip the drinks. And I remember one day my mom was like, what is wrong with little dad? And my dad was like, he is drunk. And she was like, John! My dad had the same formal name and she was horrified. But it turns out they were both people who I think suffered from this illness as most of my family did. And they were captive. I was captive. Then I realized that it restricted my personal freedom. Somebody would say, hey, you want to go to a movie? And I'd be like, well, how long is the movie? Because I didn't want to go to the movie because then I'd be like, well, maybe I could sneak out of the half, find a scene and go do some blow in the bathroom or whatever and come back. I didn't want to go to the movie. I didn't want to go to parties. I didn't want to go to church service. I didn't want to go to things because it was interfering with my drinking. And I didn't want to spend money I needed to have to keep my supply going. It was it was illuminating, and it was going to meetings and being in the recovery community that helped people help me realize just how incredibly captive I was. I'm frequently fond of saying my third DUI, that's it, no more driving at night. But now when I think about it, I'm like, oh, that's a form of captivity, right? I was willing to restrict or think I was going to restrict my driving privileges in order to like continue to drink. I was totally ball and chain, completely imprisoned in my relationship with the substances of complication in my world. And as my journey has continued, I've realized that I had behaviors that also would come up as substitutes or complements. So I think for me, sobriety is progressive, not just binary. And I love that I can tell you it's 32 years since I had my last drink. So I don't drink, and I'm not planning on not drinking today. I'm going to make that same commitment tomorrow. I make it every morning on my morning prayers. But I've been more and less addictive on any given day. I didn't have a great Friday, I will confess. I have some amends to make. A couple of my colleagues aren't here where I parked at. But anyway, we do our best one day at a time. And as long as I didn't drink, I'm like, yay! This is part of my new freedom. I have a new freedom, which is that I don't have to drink. That's like a big deal. I don't need to underplay that as a freedom. It's a tremendously important freedom. And it's a freedom that you can have. In Narcotics Anonymous, which is another one of the programs that there are now many choices that people seeking a journey of recovery can explore. The historic one is Alcoholics Anonymous, then you have Narcotics Anonymous, it's sort of its first sibling offshoot. Then you have like others which have don't like to be sort of compared per se with AA, but are in some ways also responses in the social environment. So you have Dharma Recovery, Smart Recovery, Celebrate Recovery. The Mormon traditions have very specific Mormon expressions. There's JCS, which is Jewish Family Services for Families Affected by Addiction. There are lots of different ways to find supportive community. But anyway, in Narcotics Anonymous, one of the Narcotics Anonymous sayings that I learned early on, my early recovery was very NA-focused, was only one promise. AA has a bunch of them. But Narcotics Anonymous, one promise is freedom from active addiction. So if you hear nothing else, I want you to make sure that you hear that I said, that is really important. And if that's what you want, that's the freedom that you want, great. But I just want to ask you to entertain with me the idea that possibly there is more to the AA promise of a new freedom than the freedom of just not drinking, and to kind of think about what that is. So as I learned more about my captivity, and I practiced the steps, and I grew in my sobriety, and I changed jobs, and I went to school, and I became an ordained pastor out of my atheism, eventually, I ran across a fellow named Kendall Soul, and he just had a birthday. We were just exchanging messages on Facebook, and I got a chance to tell him once again, probably the 10th time, that I was so grateful to him for changing my life. He was a professor of systematic theology at Wesley Theological Seminary. I took a class from him around 97. And I remember, I kind of remember the day I can almost put him at the little podium in the small classroom that we were in. And I remember those student desks and the hours. And, he was a gentle and wise man, still is. And we were looking at a passage where freedom is discussed in the Christian Testament. And he said, what do y'all think that means? And in the next few minutes, I was confronted with a paradigm invitation to completely change my thinking, because I guess I was 33 or 34 years old at that time, but I was a latent adolescent. I was like, failure to launch was like morally, like addiction slowed my development down as a human being. And so I remember being 15 and 16 and thinking freedom was freedom from my stupid parents. Right? And freedom from the damn law, and freedom from idiots who think weed shouldn't be legalized, and freedom from, like, those are the freedoms. They're like, you are, to me, it reminds me to some extent of the debates about masks today, and people who have argued that masks should be a matter of personal freedom. And if you believe that, I'm not trying to spark a fight, but I'm just trying to say that what I came to realize in Kendall Solon's very brief message to us in the class that day was that that's what I thought freedom was, self-indulgence. I thought freedom was my personal choice to decide that the rules don't apply to me, or which rules do and which ones don't. And do I sometimes see this feeling? I absolutely do. But what Kendall invited me to imagine was that the freedom that was spoken about in that sacred text so long ago, and that the freedom that our military and first responders fight to protect for us, I just saw my stepson, who is serving in the Coast Guard in Hawaii, on FaceTime yesterday. I hadn't talked to him face-to-face like that in a long time. And I miss him, and I'm so proud of him. He was part of a small group of his crew that were picked to do a December 7th tribute in the harbor at Pearl Harbor. And we saw pictures on camera. And I just was so proud that Jared, as a newbie, was identified. Partly he's like super camera photogenic. He looks like Adonis. He's just a beautiful, beautiful young man. And so I think they wanted the photo op of a, you know, gorgeous young man. But also, like, it was right next to his captain, so that was really pretty cool. And Jared is not fighting for me to be a jerk. Jared is not fighting to protect my right to be an idiot and to, like, self-determine and say, I don't have to follow your rules and you can't tell me what I have to do. That's not the freedom that people who have fought for this nation and died for this nation have been trying to protect, right? I mean, if you think it is, then you think that those who protect our liberties are protecting anarchy. So what the Apostle Paul in Galatians was talking about, according to Kendall, Kendall asked me to think about whether Paul was perhaps talking about, in that tradition, fulfilling God's dream for us, like for us to become what God intended. Or if you think about that in a more secular way, think about it as what your parents are, maybe your parents are really difficult, mine are sometimes difficult, maybe a benevolent grandparent, or a aunt, or somebody, but who just saw in you something precious as a little child, and was like, oh, I love you so much, whatever your name is, and I can't wait to see you grow up, because you can have, you know, you can have a wonderful life, you have family, you have a future, you can live into your vocation. That's the freedom that I want. And that's the freedom that Johnny Walker Red took from me. It took from me the right to follow, not the right, the capacity to pursue my dreams and my destiny, whatever you may not believe in destiny, but not to pursue my sense of calling and vocation, to live into my purpose, and to be. But what has happened, I will say, I'm in no ways perfect today. But I have had so many people bear witness to me over the 3+ decades of my sobriety, to things that no one ever said about me when I was drinking, that I realized that I'm being gradually made a better human being. And that to me is an unbelievable freedom, which I hold out in front of you this morning. You have the freedom to no longer be dragged down into the mud of the dregs of society, dehumanized in the way that addiction takes us out. Like it does the most horrible things, and I'm off my little script this morning, but sometimes that's God working in me that makes me say what I'm supposed to say. So I'm reminded of a guy named Bill that I knew in a church that I served. And Bill and I connected because we both suffered from addiction, but then we watched Bill careen out of his attempt at recovery and go back to smoking crack, when that was a fairly common way that this illness expresses itself. And Bill had this gorgeous, magnificent, you know, multi-story home with a water view out overlooking the ocean in this tatter style with the living room on the top floor. And I mean, it was a place that was worth tons of money, and he had nice cars and all that sort of stuff. And his now ex-wife, who I still occasionally hear from, had to throw him out and say, you know, you're not allowed to be in here because I can't deal with this anymore. And so, out of a sense of entitlement, he broke into his own home and stole his own VCR. You know what that is? Anyway, he stole his own VCR and he sold it for a bag of rock. That is degradation. That is taking a person who has a certain amount of personal dignity and worth and value. And it is the cocaine in that case that dragged him out of his humanity. can't wander around with a magic wand and touch Steve and Adam and Linda and Brooke and each of you, I don't know where you're all in it, but each of the persons in the room today, and give you back that dignity and that worth instantaneously. In fact, I think you have the worth inherently. I deeply believe that. I believe that all of us are persons of infinite worth. But I must ask you to believe that this is worth fighting for. And that this is part of what you are fighting for. And that there is a way to reclaim your dignity. One of the challenges of being here is that our patients come in and they are burdened down with things like shame and resentment. That's almost two flip sides of a similar coin. Because the bad things that have gone down may, in one person, make you feel so horrible because you take it on yourself, or in another person, make you so furious because it's all because of X, Y, Z. And neither of those, I believe, is the true situation. I believe that the captivity that has happened, or having been taken hostage, the brain scientists would agree with me, the hijacked brain of addiction, Johnny Walker Red, driving my behavior, makes me lose my capacity to exercise moral choice, and I make these survival-based choices, which hurt me and others, and drop me out of the dignity of my station. Oh, I'm so grateful that that is now something I feel is having happened so long ago. But it might be very fresh for you. I was thinking also on my drive in about the wristband. You could think of it like a virtual handcuff. It's a sign of your captivity. And I don't mean to ask you to think of this as jail, because treatment is the beginning of the launching of your freedom. It is not the ending of a sentence. This is not a sentence. This is the beginning of your liberation. I forget what they call it, but when astronauts come back from space and they're like debriefed or put in like a cleansing tank before they are able to. That's how I would encourage you to think about this. This is not punishment, this is preparation for the fulfillment of the hopes and dreams that you and others have held for you, which now can perhaps come back to the table in some newly thought way. And I think that's like the best news I ever share. The only other thing I wanted to say was, that outline I had. It is the week of the shortest daylight day of the year. It is the week in which the Jewish community remembers that light persisted in darkness. It is almost the week in which the Christian community celebrates light and darkness. And in the Northern Hemisphere, I don't think that the confluence of those three observations are merely coincidence. And we live in a time right now where captivity and oppression to misery is, I think, predominating in a very understandable way. How could you not be anxious and worried? Mental health, I'm an advocate for mental health within my denomination, and helping the churches within my denomination seek to be more welcoming to people who have various kinds of mental health concerns. But what we're observing is that anxiety and depression is way, way up. And that even people who had suffered but were well managed with things like bipolar disorders and others who are more complicated personality disorders, while they were more regulated pre-COVID in this environment, all that stuff is just getting activated. It would be great to believe that we are on the cusp of brighter days. I don't mean just in terms of length of day, but in terms of a kind of spiritual quality. Not just for you, I deeply believe that for you. And I hope you will fight for that no matter what the heck happens in 2021, in our global concerns about climate and politics and you know, whatever else, economics, whatever is the big worry that has you down. I pray that you will not let those externals stop you from experiencing the new freedom. And I will promise you what it says in the promises, that there is work to do to achieve this climb back to dignity. And it involves inventory and sharing that with a trusted mentor, guide, or person if you follow the 12-step way. There's parallel things in the Buddhist and other traditions that offer invitations to people to follow paths of recovery. But anyway, I'm a deep 12-stepper still. And So inventory, understanding my resentments, my fears, my relationship history, and taking a hard look at it. And then especially looking at the harms I've done in seeking to make amends. And what the book promises is that if I had been painstaking in this phase of my development, doing that hard work to sort of see the harm behind me and take account of how much it has affected other people, we will be amazed before we are halfway through. I don't have this passage exactly in memory because I'm going to share what I remember. We will know a new freedom and a new happiness. We will comprehend the word serenity and we will know peace. No matter how far down the scale we have gone, we will see how our experience can be of benefit to others. Self-seeking will slip away. Fear of economic insecurity will leave us. We will intuitively know how to handle situations with fears and baffles. We will suddenly realize that God is doing for us what we could not do for ourselves. And it continues, many of us may know this. Are these extravagant promises? And often the community will say, we think not! They continue to manifest, sometimes quickly, sometimes slowly. They always will, we will, if we work for them. That's the essence of the writing. You have this new freedom in front of you. I pray that I would be for you, one of you out here listening or in the room today, what kind of soul must be. A person who holds an awakening for you of like a climb back to dignity. And you deserve it. You're entitled to it. I believe it's inherent in each of us to sort of fight for that and to become the best that you can be instead of allowing the substances and behaviors that are holding you captive to drag you down to becoming the worst that we can be, or to death and suicide. Which seems to be where many of us would have ended up had this invitation not happened. That's my promise to you. Do the work.